Happy holidays, everyone. I've always wanted to say that in a church, just to see if anybody would leave. But before that happens, let me correct myself. Merry Christmas, everyone. And I hope you're all having a great one. Now, if you're like me, when Christmas rolls around, you probably do a little bit of shopping, spend time with family, go to church, and a little extra because it is Jesus' birthday. But you're probably going to run into a friend or a relative that's got a glee in their eye and a smirk on their face. They're going to come up to you and go, you know, it's really a pagan holiday. You're welcome. How many of you have had someone in your life do that to you at least some point to try to tell you, you know, it's really pagan? Typically, it's innocent, but every now and again, you get one of those ultra fundamentalist people that are like, you may celebrate that pagan holiday, but I want to be extra holy for God, so I abstain entirely. I don't want to accidentally worship a pagan idol, your Christmas tree, guys. Now, I'm going to show you today, there is not a scrap of evidence Christmas is pagan. And that's not coming from me, that's coming from historians like Ronald Hutton, Thomas Schmidt, Thomas Taley, Stephen Hidgmans, Tanya Gulovich. But before I get there, let's just say for the sake of argument, it is a pagan holiday. Originally, that's what it was, and the early Christians were like, you know what, we're gonna take over this holiday and use it for good. I get a lot of really fundamentalist Christians sometimes come say, you know, you can't do that because God hates anything that's pagan. And they'll sometimes use this passage from Deuteronomy. When the Lord your God cuts off before you the nations whom you go into dispossess and dispossesses them and dwell in their land, take care that you do not ensnare to follow them after they have been destroyed before you, and that you do not inquire about their gods, saying, how did these nations serve their gods? That I may do the same. You shall not worship the Lord your God in that way, for every abominable thing that the Lord hates, they have done for their gods. So they'll say, see, God hates whatever pagans do. Don't do that. Checkmate Christmas. Again, let's use a little reason here. Did God command Israel to sacrifice animals before him? Yes. Pagan nations sacrificed animals to their gods. Did God command Israel to build a temple? Pagans built temples. Do pagans breathe air? Well, God said we can breathe air. So maybe it doesn't mean everything. And it does seem to imply you can't do every abominable practice. Things like burning your sons and daughters in fire to their gods. In fact, the symbol of Christianity technically used to be a Roman torture device used by pagans. And now it's a symbol of victory. Now, I get some Christians that'll be like, well, you can't even use the cross. That's also a pagan symbol. We got to reject that. Well, let me go one step further. Let me read from Acts. Paul tells the Athenians, for in him we live and move and have our being, and even as some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Now, if you don't know, Paul is actually quoting pagans. Epimenides and Aratus. Aratus was a Stoic philosopher and a pantheist. And Paul says his words, well, I'm going to use those to talk about the God of Israel. So right there, we see in Scripture, God takes something that a pagan meant for evil, he uses it for good. He reclaims it. You meant this to talk about your pantheist Stoic God? Well, now it's about me. And this is what we tend to get in Scripture if you read it. Just because a pagan may have used something for evil in the past, that doesn't mean it is now evil or wrong for us. We see this very clearly in 1 Corinthians 8. Paul here is talking about meat that may have been sacrificed to an idol, and now it's being sold at a market. And he's like, who cares? Like, just because we know there's only one God, and he, guess what? He made all the meat. So he's the one who's really in control. As long as you're not going to cause your brother to stumble in some way, there's nothing to abstain from. Just because a pagan may have you know, honored it or dedicated it to Zeus, that doesn't mean it's now wrong for you. Just because a pagan used something in the past, that doesn't mean it's wrong for Christians in the present. And I'm going to give you one of my favorite verses, 1 Corinthians 15. For he must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death. Okay? Who's reigning? Zeus? Ra? Marduk? The pine tree god? No. Jesus is reigning, and he is putting all things under his feet. Guess what? That includes pine trees, mistletoe, Easter eggs, bunnies, you name it. Everything can be used to honor our God. And he did the same thing, as I pointed out, in Acts 17. But wait, the fundamentalist is ready for this. They got a passage they want to go to. And I'm sure you probably have heard this, Jeremiah 10. Learn not the ways of the nation, nor be dismayed at the signs of the heaven, because for the custom of the people are vanity. A tree from the forest is cut down and worked with an axe by the hands of a craftsman. They decorate it with silver and gold. They fasten it with a hammer and nails. Checkmate. God says you cannot decorate trees with silver and gold. Is that really what this passage is saying? Do you think ancient Canaanites had Christmas trees? Let's be a little reasonable here. Every scholar who has written on Jeremiah 10, and I mean every scholar who has written a commentary, mentioned it, will tell you this is not about decorating trees. It's about making an idol. A craftsman cuts down wood. They fashion it with their hands, and then they decorate it with silver and gold. It's an idol they're crafting, and we see this in the following verse. They are like scarecrows in a cucumber field. They cannot speak. They have to be carried, for they cannot walk. That's an idol. No one has to remind the audience that trees cannot walk or cannot speak. But if you see an idol, it typically has legs and feet, and it has a mouth. Again, there is not one scholar who says Jeremiah 10 is about Christmas trees. The only people who say that are laymen on the internet who have not done research. Where did the Christmas tree come from, though? Let's answer this question. Because now let's see if it really does go back to paganism. No. Here's a historian. She says, in 1561, an ordinance posted in Alsace declared that each burg was allowed only one Christmas tree, and that his tree could be no more than 8 shoes in height. This is the first mention of Christmas trees in the historical record that we have. 1561. You think Canaanite paganism was running around Alsace, France at this point? Probably not. We're not really sure where the Christmas tree came from, but from what I can gather, the most likely explanation that Tanya Gulovich talks about is it actually is entirely Christian in origin. You see, in the Middle Ages, they liked to do a lot of plays. They didn't have YouTube or TikTok, so they did plays. And December 24th was the feast day of Adam and Eve, and they would celebrate it with an Adam and Eve play. Now, if you've ever been to Europe, on December 24th, you'll notice there's not a lot of trees available, but there are pine trees available. So they would gather a pine tree, decorate it with apples, and apples, by the way, are the earliest form of ornaments, and they would perform the Adam and Eve play. And then after, you don't waste food in Middle Ages in the Europe, so people would probably gather around and eat the apples off of the paradise tree, as it was called. So most historians that have written on this topic will say the most likely explanation is Christmas trees morphed from paradise trees used in Adam and Eve plays on December 24th. Very innocent origin, no paganism regardless. But what about the infamous date of December 25th? And there is the man himself, the evil emperor Constantine, who is used in every Hollywood movie as the guy who ruined everything. As you know, the myth is, well, December 25th was a pagan holiday, and the Christians decided to hijack it under Constantine, and they Christianized it. They said, well, this was, you know, originally a celebration of the sun god, but now we're going to use it to honor Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It sounds plausible on the surface, I'll say. Just one problem. There's no evidence of it. None whatsoever. This is a guy called Ronald Hutton. Now, he is not a Christian. I think he describes himself more as like an agnostic, druid, pagan type person in Britain. Okay? So he doesn't actually even care. But he says, the official calendar of Julius Caesar marked the solstice. That's December 25th, according to the Julian calendar. The traditional pagan Roman calendar had left this period as a quiet and mysterious one and flanked it instead with a festival prepared, with a festival of preparation and one of completion. The former was the Feast of Saturn, the Saturnalia, in the days after December 17th. In the latter, the New Year feast, from the 1st to the 3rd of January. So he says, you know, if you look at the early Roman calendars prior to Constantine, they don't mention any holiday on December 25th. None. There was no big winter solstice celebration, as we've been told. The earliest source that will mention a pagan festival on December 25th is something called the Philokalian calendar, which dates to the year 354 AD. Now, if you know, that's actually post-Emperor Constantine. And what a lot of historians will note is that maybe, because the Christians were celebrating Christmas as far back as mid-200s on December 25th, that maybe when Constantine took power, the pagans needed their own celebration on December 25th. So they put a sun celebration on that day after Constantine, because it doesn't show up in any earlier calendars that the Romans had. So there's no reason to think that they had that date and Christians stole it. Well, what about if we go further north? We all know about the story of Yule. Yes, Yule. Christians took this Norse holiday of Yule and they turned it into Christmas. Well, this guy is an Icelandic chronicler, historian, lived about 1,000 years ago or so. He says King Hakon, who is of Norway, when he was confirmed as a Christian when he arrived, he had established in the laws that Yule celebration was to take place the same time as it was the custom of the Christians. Guess what that means? Yule could not have been on December 25th prior to King Hakon the Good. That means it was a different time of the year prior to this. So, why do we celebrate Christmas on December 25th? If it's not for paganism, why? Well, the answer is quite simple. Early Christians were doing their own calculations. In the early church, there was this belief that a prophet should die on the same day he was conceived. And they were convinced Jesus died on March 25th. Count forward 9 months. You get December 25th. Pretty simple. Now, even if there was a pagan holiday on December 25th, that would not mean that Christians put Jesus' birthday on that date because of paganism. They were doing their own calculations. And it's kind of ironic because pagans had a lot of gods, a lot of festivals to celebrate those gods. Christians just happened to pick a date there wasn't one on. But let's talk about Santa Claus now. Everyone knows Santa is a revamped old pagan deity like Odin. Is that correct? No, that is not correct. Santa is, as you would expect, Saint Nicholas. I can't believe I still have to even point this out to people online. These are some of the earliest depictions of Santa Claus. Here's the story. You get this in places like the Dictionary of English Folklore, Encyclopedia of Christmas and New Year's. In the 1800s, Christmas had become this kind of drunken celebration, and there were people in the city of New York who wanted to make it a more family-centered holiday. Well, the feast of St. Nicholas was earlier in the month of December, so they said, you know, he was a gift-giving saint. He gave gifts to children. Why don't we sort of take him, move this saint to December 25th, and sort of revamp Christmas? So he was redressed, remade in the traditional attire of a Dutchman from that period, a big red suit. Dutchmen in New York would wear big red suits. So Santa Claus started to be depicting that way. And Dutch immigrants really still venerated and loved St. Nicholas even after the Protestant Reformation. So this is how it all sort of got started. Dutch immigrants in New York in the 1800s, revamping St. Nicholas into Santa Claus. Then he was exported around the world. He became a phenomenon. In 1927, a Finnish radio broadcaster named Marcus Radio decided, I'm gonna take this Santa Claus, I'm gonna rebrand him as Joulupukki, which is a pagan deity. So, Santa Claus is entirely Christian in origin, and as he got exported around the world, he then started blending with pagan stuff in places like Finland and Norway. But he originally, no, St. Nicholas. It does not go back to paganism. Paganism was added in less than 100 years ago at this point. Let's do a hard one now. Wanna do a hard one? You think I can take it? Yule logs. Yule is in the name. Checkmate, Christians. How does that not go back to paganism? All right, challenge accepted. Let's quote some scholars. The word Yule in various spellings means a loosely defined midwinter period, not a single day, in the early languages of most Germanic and Scandinavian countries. There was a man at one time named Sir Henry Yule. Yule does not necessarily mean the pagan holiday of Yule. It just basically means midwinter period. Now, Yule logs actually are an English custom. The first mention if we have of any sort of special log being burned around Christmas, it comes from 1648 in Robert Herrick's poetry collection. And if you'll notice, it says Christmas log. Odd. Well, where's the first mention of Yule log? Oh, just, you know, about 40 years later. By John Aubrey, calls it a Yule log. There's the first mention of Yule log, guys. There's no evidence, goes back to paganism. Yule just meant, to the English people, a midwinter period. Okay? So, do the math. Basically, Yule probably is a word that came from Norse into English, and then when it came in, it just meant a midwinter period. And then, of course, in the winter, they like to burn logs to keep warm, so people just started calling it the Yule log, because in the midwinter time, you burn logs. So, no, Yule logs do not go back to paganism. Mistletoe does not go back to paganism. Stockings do not go back to paganism. Nativity scenes don't go back to paganism, but I've had to debunk that one, too. Eh? Nothing I can find, no major holiday tradition, goes back to paganism. You're safe. So here's what I want to tell you. If any one of your relatives comes up to you with that smirk on their face, or a friend you says, you know, Christmas is really a pagan holiday, you don't have to throw all this data at them. Just do this. What ancient sources show Christmas is pagan? They won't have any. You know how I know? Because I've asked that question year after year and I never get any. 9 times out of 10, they just leave or they say, Google it. Okay, well, I did and you're wrong, so there. Every now and then they'll give me a source. They'll be like, well, it's mentioned in St. Bede. Where in St. Bede? Give me the passage, I'd like to read it. I wanna look it up myself, please give me the passage. They won't have it because there's no evidence it's pagan. It just isn't. No early Christians said, we're gonna take this pagan holiday and rework it for Jesus. No early Christian said, stop celebrating on December 25th, that's really a pagan holiday. No. We don't start seeing that until later in the Middle Ages when they're trying to figure out where this date came from, and they started to posit that it maybe had been a pagan holiday. But they were wrong, and that's what a lot of historians today will note. Now, I'm gonna let you know a little secret, though. I actually wish Christmas was a pagan holiday. I wish it was originally a pagan holiday and the Christian church decided to revamp it, take it, use it, and say, you know what, now we're gonna honor Jesus. Why? Well, I can explain it to you in the form of a meme. But pagans use evergreen fir trees. Yes, I celebrate one of the holiest days of the year by decorating my home with trophies of my vanquished foes. Now, here's the important thing I want you to take away from this. Who's reigning? It's not the pine tree God, okay? Jesus is reigning. And he has sort of taken everything and he's putting it under his feet. And I'll give you an example. So I'm not sure if I'm allowed to show this image in a Protestant church, but here's the Vatican. Sorry. But I want you to focus on that right there. That's an obelisk from Egypt. Emperor Caligula, around 37 AD, took that from Egypt and placed it in Rome. Pagan emperor moved it from Egypt to Rome. That's been there. What are the Christians going to do? Well, we're not ISIS. We're not going to destroy an ancient monument that has been there since ancient Egypt. So in the 1500s, Pope Sixtus removed the pagan dedications, placed that cross on top, and rededicated it as a symbol of a finger pointing up to Christ. Now, I'm not saying we need to go do that to anything that's pagan out there, but I think this is the mentality we need to have. You meant that for evil? Fine, we'll take it and use it for good. You decided that you're going to use something that, to honor your pagan God? Well, guess what? Now it's ours. Because there's only one God reigning, and that's Christ. Paul says in Ephesians, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. What captives? Well, as I said, Christ is reigning. He's putting all things under his feet. Well, who? Well, everything that may have been used to pagan. I'm going to show you one of my favorite pieces of artwork out there from about a century ago. This is called The Triumph of Christianity Over Paganism. I love this image. I could stare at this for hours. It's just amazing to see Christianity triumphing over paganism, as I love it. There are the pagan gods falling before the cross. The symbol that they crucified the Lord with is what is their downfall now. Roman torture device. We're going to put our enemies on that cross, kill you before our gods. And now look at it. It's defeating them. They no longer reign. There are no temples to Zeus today. Now, I want you to think, what did Christ give us when Paul says in Ephesians he gave gifts to men? He gave us a spirit of victory. You're not supposed to live in fear. You think the devil has any power now? You think Zeus has power? No. You can't accidentally worship a pagan god. Some people have told me that if you put a present under a fir tree, you're bowing down to that fir tree. Guys, you can't accidentally worship a pagan deity. I've not been walking through the forest and trip, stand in front of a tree and go, oh, dang it, I accidentally worshiped the tree. That's not how it works. How much power do you think the devil has if you're somehow honoring a pagan deity by putting presents under a tree? There was a pastor that I was responding to about Halloween recently, and he was saying, you know, if you put your kid in a costume, you're helping worship the devil. And I'm like, how much power do you think the devil has on October 31st? That you just dress your kid up like the Avengers and let them get candy? You're somehow honoring the devil? Do you think Christ living in you is that weak? Do you think he's that insecure? That he's worried about pine trees and collecting candy or Easter eggs? He is not. I can guarantee you he is far more powerful and far more secure to worry about these kinds of things. Even if it did go back to paganism, he's claimed it for his own. God created all the trees, all the days of the year. He's got dibs on December 25th in pine trees. I'm sorry. That's just the rule. But what if you come across that guy that's like, look, I just really don't want to celebrate Christmas. I just feel a conviction on my heart not to. Fine. Romans 14, some people abstain from certain foods, some do not. No one judge. If you don't want to celebrate Christmas, fine. But then don't come with that holier-than-thou attitude and go, neither should you if you really want to be holy like me. You're not. And that is a dangerous, dangerous mentality. It's the very thing that led to the fall, the beginning fall. You guys remember this verse from Genesis 3? Eve says to the serpent, we were told that you shall not eat of the fruit of the tree that is in the midst of the garden, neither shall you touch it. Anyone notice a problem? God never said they couldn't touch the tree. They could have swung from it. They could have climbed it. They could have slept in it. They just couldn't eat from it. But Eve and Adam decided they're going to add an additional law, an additional tradition on top of God's law, so they're extra protected. And as we know, that actually led to the downfall. Sometimes we think we need to help God. Yeah, I know he didn't really outlaw Christmas in the Bible, but I just really feel like we shouldn't be doing it because it's going to really make us extra holy. What, you think God got it wrong? You think he didn't get it right the first time? You got to add your additional traditions of men to help God's law along by saying that, oh yeah, Christmas is, you know, really we shouldn't be doing it. And if we don't, it would make the church far more holy. It's funny that people that are trying to help God along sometimes are the ones that lead to the biggest disasters. So I want to leave you with this here. There is no evidence Christmas is a pagan holiday. There's none whatsoever. Christmas is not pagan. And even if it was, and I kind of wish, I still do, it doesn't matter. Christ has reclaimed it. We serve a secure and powerful God who is not so weak that his followers will accidentally be honoring pagan deities or the devil by putting presents under a tree. Let me repeat, how weak do you think Christ is living in you? He's not. He can handle a few pine trees. So celebrate Christmas, but remember Christ is what Christmas is really about. Don't make presents more. Don't make materialism more. Focus on Christ. But having some additional customs is not inherently evil. God is not going to be offended or mad about that, as long as we don't put those above him, which I think should be obvious. Now, if you want more, I do have a YouTube channel. You can see more there. I cover a lot of different topics there. But if you want to, like, if you get that relative that's really bothering you, and I know sometimes we get that guy, send them this video, Top 10 Christmas Traditions and Their Origin Story. I know that some people in here probably have got that guy that they encounter with Facebook that's like, you know, like, I'm not going to celebrate Christmas, and neither should you. Send them this video. If you go to YouTube and you just type in that title, you'll find it easily, and send it to them. And I guarantee they won't watch it, but at least you have something to throw at them. And this will also give you far more data to show you that Christmas is not pagan. So with that, let's close in prayer. Father, we thank you for giving us a spirit of victory. We don't have to fear the devil or his minions or any puny pagan deity out there. We know you have triumphed over them with the cross. You've given us victory, gifts to men, we now reign, and we are honored to be able to celebrate your victories. And we do that in one way through Christmas, when the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. For that, we thank you, we praise you. Amen.